This is an RMK production. Welcome to One Queen, Two Kings, episode 5. At RMK Productions, our mission is to uplift voices with a platform to share stories, experiences, and perspectives using the framework of teaching, learning, and modeling. Our purpose is hope, helping other people every day, creating avenues of support through advertisers and sponsors whose words and actions are directly in line with our mission, which is reach one, teach one. Today, we have a special episode. We're going to be talking and sharing music about protest and Black consciousness music and the history around it. Now, before we get into the music, let's just talk a little bit about what Black consciousness music really is, right? Now, for me, from my perspective and how I've seen it, it's a creative expression that is meant to change the consciousness of Black people so that we can create the types of conditions we want for our people. It really speaks to social issues, the political climate, during that time. So we're going to take you through a few decades of music. Each one of us will share some lyrics and songs of a group or artists that have used their voice for the people. So we're going to kick it off with Kevin, because he's the elder in the group. So he's going to start us off with some music from the 20s and 30s, right, Kevin?
We are breaking open the box. We are breaking open the secrets. All right. Back in the 70s, there was a group called the Temptations, Attempting Temptations. Five young men that had a message. They had a beat. They had a certain style. But also they had a responsibility for encouraging, promoting, and telling everyone what was going on through the world. Throughout our history, music has been that secret messenger that told us what was going on. So we had drugs, we had girls, we had hobnail boots, we had bell-bottom pants, we had temptations. Oh yes, Otis, hit that note. Eddie Kendricks, David Ruffin, brothers. Oh God, so good looking. All right, I'm gonna bring it down and I'm gonna talk about it. Yeah, that was my day. I'm 62 years of old. I've heard things and seen things and experienced things you guys have only seen in the movies. But I also want to tell you that the responsibility of the message that was on the street wasn't always told by what was in the newspaper, what was reported on the news, or the conversation that was on the porch. The real messenger was our talent. You know, you had Gladys Knight talking about, you know, leaving on the midnight train from Georgia. There was also a secret message there. You had the Tempting Temptations that talked about, you know, war. What is it good for when we're just coming out of the Vietnam War? We had the Manhattans. We had the Intruders. We had the Commodores, all talking about the plight and the message of the people. And then we had the introduction to what we now know as rap. It was those people that, you know, basically had an intro that, you know, we were kind of talking about how things were going. And so the real thing was the message is that when you're doing well in life, we all hear the beat. When we are struggling, we start listening to the words, because the words are the answers to those unwritten questions that we don't have answers to. And they seem to put everything together. So when you wake up in the morning and you look out your window and your view is not the same view that everyone else sees, the music brings everything into perspective. And that's Kevin McLemore. All right.
Kevin, I got a question for you about the music of that time too. You know, when Berry Gordy started Motown, there was a purpose behind that, right? The reason why he wanted to create Motown for Black artists. You know, what for you, what was that like to experience this label, you know, this record label that brought all the Black artists on, you know, and they were all hits. I mean, every last one of them was hits. So, you know, what did that mean to see something like that in that time?
Well, believe it or not, going through my era, a person of color, and I'm going to say Black, we were all trying to find our identity and our position. Music had been one of those doors that seemed to be open, but we had to push it open. And a lot of times record labels would hear Black music, and then when the record was played, it was performed by, you know, the Carpenters, you know, white groups. And then when you got a record deal, you actually didn't get the record deal, the same deal that the white artists were giving. Barry Gordy opened that door and created a music factory. He took troubled youth that had a voice and put them together. He taught them how to dress. He taught them how to walk. He taught them how to do interviews. And he taught them the power of their voice. And he set up messages where music actually was music. There was no synthesizing sound, words. A drummer played the drum, bass player played the bass, and lead singer that had a falsetto like Eddie Kendricks and many of the other people from Enchantments and everything else, those were their voice. There was not a keystroke that brought the octaves up. There was not a keystroke or a button to be pushed that created harmony. There was always four or five people that were separated at birth, but bond together by a purpose and a choice, a lot like us. And Barry Gordy saw that opportunity, and he created a home in order for artists to prevail. You know, Diana Ross started out the Supremes. You know, Eddie Kendricks was brought in, you know, to the Temptations and made it whole. David Ruffin and Otis was the Temptations. And the stories go on and on and on. And it gave birth to the Sounds of Philadelphia, you know, coming from Detroit. But it was that Hall of Fame music maker, Barry Gordy, that launched everything. And even when it comes to bringing in Michael and the Jackson Five, he saw music had a place other than just sound. He saw music had a place in politics, in our social wealth, in our identity as people. And believe it or not, you know, sold music. And I always wanted to be a DJ. I lived across the street from a guy by the name of Kirk Logan. And he used to get up every morning and I would hear him. This is Kirk Logan, WDAO, Soul Radio. Nice guy. I want to be that voice. And he would play the Tempting Temptations. He would go on through the Commodores and the OJs. And it just went on. And every child on the street had a little band, a little group. We were singing four-part harmony on the streets, thinking we could be the Temptations or whatever. So it kept a dream alive, especially, you know, when you looked at your surroundings, and your surroundings did not define that dream, but music gave an opportunity. I grew up in a neighborhood where, you know, a couple houses over, there's a group called Lakeside. Thomas Shelby, William Shelby played in Shalimar. You know, Roger Trotman, you know, was a neighbor. I was lucky enough to be in a group that we opened up for a guy by the name of Peebo Bryson. I knew Gladys, Arian Love from the Stylistics. Those days just bring me back. I'm going to tell you, you guys, you think you're lucky being born in the era that you are, but you don't know luck until you actually got a chance to sit at a barbecue with the Spinners and the Temptations and the OJs, and you get to know them as a person. And then, believe it or not, you get to add in your little voice and listen to them laugh while you're trying to hit that note. Hey, dreams do come true. And that's what life's all about. So I'm happy that we're doing this in the music, because right now, the music is that messenger for us. It's the uncoded word in order to get to the people. And it's a distraction from the reality of what we have, but it also paints a picture of our responsibilities of where we should, what we should be doing and where we should be going. Music is that messenger.
Yeah, it's funny because, you know, in my house, that music was playing. You know, I have older brothers and sisters who, you know, my older brothers were in the service. And so when they were home, and my older sister, before she got married, this was their music. And so like my memories of some of these artists that you referred to bring me back to like what was happening in my community. I grew up in the project. So a lot of, you know, in the summer, you had the fire hydrants, you know, people popped the fire hydrants up. It was too hot. People didn't have air conditioning, so they were getting wet. And so I remember, you know, music playing and kids being outside and parents being in the window. All those communal things were happening in my neighborhood. And so the music resonates for me for that reason. And I could think about like my brother's girlfriends coming to the house and, you know, these guys trying to be smooth operators and that kind of thing. So it brings all of that back, you know, eating cornbread and collard greens in the middle of the day. You know, the music is about more than just, you know, who the artists were, but it was during the times and kind of what it meant to people. And, you know, during that time, and I was a kid, so I remember all these things come to mind when I listen to you talk about those particular artists. My mother liked the OJs, and so you would hear, you know, she would play the OJs. You know, so it's the connectivity is across a life experience too. You know what I mean? Whether you met the people or not, you still remember what it was like if you heard the music. And even now, and I hear like the Shy Lights or, you know, any of those groups, I think about me, one, being a kid, and two, like my brothers and sisters being older and what was happening in their lives as I was growing up and I was looking and watching what they was doing. You know, it brings back a lot of memories. So I appreciate you, you know, sharing.
Well you got to think about is that music was the first opportunity we had as people of color becoming entrepreneurs. You know, it wasn't like, you know, you can go to Hollywood, had to take acting classes and whatever. It's like you went out and says, Raymond, can you hit this note? Oh, we got the baritone. Raymond has a brother that has a real deep voice. Maybe he can go down there and sound like Otis and whatever. And you can put four people together. And it was the first time that you can sit there with a band of brothers or sisters and create a sound and provide yourself with an opportunity that, you know, to go to your local talent show, you know, to record. Back then and there, you guys probably don't even know what this is. It's called a cassette tape. Record that and try to get some of the.
He said a cassette tape. Listen, I remember talent shows. I remember cassette tapes, 8 tracks, you know, because my brothers, you know, had cars. And so, yeah. You know, and then, you know, this is what music was then. And I that's what I understood it to be when I was a kid. But I think about like during that time, we were also a community, a Black community that was trying to be positive and talking about love and being, you know, being in love and loving in our community. That was a big part of it. As I think back to my childhood during that time, that's the message I remember. You know, yeah. It was all about, you know, sexual healing and, you know, yeah. just a lot of the community love and then like in interpersonal love and finding the right woman. And it was a lot of music about, you know, dudes singing the blues, his heart's yeah. broken. And yeah. but it was about coming together. And seeking out something positive, you know. And yeah. if you think about during that time, I mean, obviously you were there. There was a lot that we were trying to recover from in the community as well. You know, the marches and the fire hose spraying and all that. Yeah. And so we were introverted is what I think about during that time. Even think about my brothers and sisters, like, you know, even if they was out smoking their little marijuana or whatever, you know, getting their little drink on. Yeah. It wasn't to go out in a and do harm in the world. It was like be together, you know, yeah. have fun together, you know, yeah. get with some girls, get with some dudes, you know, it was yeah. that kind of thing during that time. So I was a kid, that's what I remember.
The lyrics had meaning, they had depth to them, right? You could when you heard the lyrics, it was telling a story, and you didn't have to try to interpret it because they said what they said, you know? So it was plain, whether it was about, you know, that woman, whether it was about, you know, what's happening in our community, whatever yeah. it was about, it's like, that was it. And you didn't need to try to interpret it.
Yeah, that's true.
You didn't. Every song that was played back in those days says something to your heart. You know, it's like today is raining. You look outside, you can't get to your girl, and all of a sudden the radio comes on and outside my window, I've been business. Last one is gone away to rest. And then you just go on and say, God, you know, that feels good. That feels good talking to that girl. Mm-hmm. Especially if you're like me, you stuttered, you didn't have the right words. You can always sing a little song and hopefully she filled in the gaps. So, hey, if you haven't noticed, I was not cool when I was young, so I needed music.
we all need music for a different, you know, different seasons and times. I always say that no matter what we're going through, we can find a song that will speak to us. And, you know, for me, and so as I take us into the 70s, right, that's when I was a child. I was born in 69. So, you know, if you look at pictures of me when I'm little, I'm dancing. My parents are always entertaining. Music's always on. And I'm right in the middle dancing. Still today, music comes on, I'm dancing, okay? So, but, you know, as I was researching this and really thinking about, you know, Black consciousness music, protest music, I was thinking about, you know, like Marvin Gaye, What's Going On, right? I was even thinking about Billie Holiday, you know, Strange Fruit, right? They did a documentary on her about that. And then I finally thought about this one artist that his music is timeless and it speaks to the African experience for Black people all over the world that they can understand. It speaks to what's happening in this country today, like in America. It speaks to what's happening. And when I was listening to the music, I got to tell you, it took me a little off task because I just had this vibe all day. I just had this vibe and I couldn't stop. So it's Robert Nesta Marley, Bob Marley. And, as I was reading up about his life, you know, he has a white father, Black mother who's Jamaican, but he always self-identified as a Black African, okay? He was influenced by, you know, the Pan-African leaders like Marcus Garvey. And his music, everybody knows his music. Everybody, white, Black, brown, you know, get up, stand up, all of that. They know that. And you could look at his music and you could see the message and all of his songs, right? But the one that really stuck out for me that made a difference was the song War. And what I didn't know was that Selassie, the Ethiopian emperor of that time, he had made a speech to the United Nations in 1963. And this song, the lyrics from the song is actually taken from this speech, right? The first lines of the song, it really stays true to the speech. And then he sort of, you know, alters it in some way. So I'm just gonna share with you some of the lyrics. He says, until the philosophy which holds one race superior and another inferior is finally and permanently discredited and abandoned, everywhere is war. Me say war. That until there is no longer first class, second class citizen of any nation, until the color of a man's skin is of no more significance than the color of his eyes, me say war. Mm-hmm. That until the basic human rights are equally guaranteed to all without regard to race, this is war. I mean, look at that. Truth. You know, and then he put this in a song. Listen, when you play this song, when you get a chance, okay? And just the way he is, the inflection points of this song and the way he's singing these lyrics, I'm telling you, man, there is no way by hearing this song and singing this song that you can't want more in your community, that you can't feel inspired to do more in your community. Every one of his songs has a purpose to raise consciousness of not just Black people, because he's singing to everybody right now, right? All people. There's not been, in my opinion, there's not been another artist like him since. But this is the kind of music that inspires me and moves me, you know, in my activism work and what I'm doing. Africa, Jamaica, you know, those countries, those Caribbean islands, they will always be speaking to that. You know, they'll always be speaking to these kinds of issues. The I Shot the Sheriff song, right?
Right.
You know, it's talking about police brutality.
But he didn't shoot the deputy. But I did not shoot the deputy. He shot the sheriff. But he did not shoot the deputy.
That's right. You know, so it's just, for me, that right there is some powerful music. And I want to hear more of that. That's what I want more of in my life. Yeah.
I think the other thing, and I'm glad you brought up Bob Marley. Man, what you mentioned, though, is that he was also a student of humanity. It wasn't, you know, the music became a vehicle for him. You know, he was, a Garveyite. And, you know, he understood what those scholars were talking about. And you know, he understood because it translated. He synthesized what he understood and what he saw in his life experiences through his music, which was his conduit. Those guys spoke and did books and did schools and, you know, the education construct. And he synthesized what he was learning in those spaces into the music. But I'm going to talk a lot about that when I get to the generation I'm talking about, and it'll be more about that piece of it. But I agree with you. I think he's one of my favorites ever, Bob Marley, you know, so.
I think when you list your top 10 of people that are favorites in music that made an impact on people's lives, I think he's always going to be in the top five, because he transitions in the 60s, the 70s, the 80s, and to present day. Believe it or not, I actually have a personal story. I had a limousine ride with Ziggy Marley back in the 80s.
Ooh, Ziggy.
I ran a health facility in Cleveland, Ohio. And when we were doing a weekend promotion, Ziggy Marley was the first band that we brought in. And I got an opportunity to go out in a limo, go out on the tarp to pick him up from his private plane, ride back, and I don't have to fill in the details of how that ride I had never been happier in my life. But you can't look at Ziggy and listen to him and not know the impact, because as much as they say that we are, as people, not literate people, not well read, the lyrics and the words and the position the entertainers like Ziggy Marley and Bob Marley and other people before him, the Temptations and all those people that lived through the struggle, that tried to give us that space where we can escape the reality and dream a little bit. Those people were, through the music, literary masters, because even if you couldn't read the words on the page, you understood the words in the song. And so I remember those days.
Yeah, Bob Marley had an influence on other artists as well. Like the focus that he had on social conscious music, it did spill across the roads. I mean, if you look back at artists that, like white artists, Peter Gabriel, for instance, you know, he did the song in 1980. Between 80 and 85, maybe it was before 85. I think it was 80, 81 or somewhere in there. The song about Stephen Biko, you know, and the apartheid. And he was interviewed at one point. And I remember him saying that, like, he thought about music as being able to impact everybody in the world. And that's how he saw music. I mean, if you look at some of his old videos and such now, even the way he performs, it's in a very communal kind of way. So Africana affected his way of being an artist, you know, and he talked a lot about, you know, what happened with Biko. You know, he got banned from going to Africa. He couldn't go to Africa and perform. They didn't want him there, you know, because he was of white skin, talking about the apartheid and the injustices that were happening to black people. So he, you know, he was even influenced by, you know, Bob Marley and using the music as a platform for social consciousness and impacting people's perspectives around the world. So,
well, let me say this before we go on to yours, because I just thought about this. If you look at the impact of Bob Marley and the music industry and compared to different cultures today, the reggae music and the reggae sound, the message has been consistent with Latin music. The message has been consistent of impacting the people. The only music that has basically changed, that has not built up the people, is what we used to call R&B, or what we used to call soul, and what we have, rap. There was never anything in the music that put a woman down or put her in a position where she couldn't be respected. And there was never a time period to where there's something that needed to be changed was not mentioned in the music. And today it's just noise. You know, no one's taken a position on the impact the music has on the people, to rally the people. We have not seen We Are the World, you know, since the world changed with the death of people like Prince, Michael Jackson, some other people. So when we get to present day, which my son is not here, we'll speak on that. But Raymond, I'm dying to hear what you've got to say, because, you know.
Yeah, he's going into those 80 years when I was in high school and stuff like that. And I'm like, oh yeah, that music back then, boy, yes. Yeah. But you know what was great about the 80s too? And I know who you're going to bring up, but the 80s also, to me, it had a lot of international sounds as well. I think that was one of the decades that we heard the most international music of all. But the music still, again, stayed true to heart. So who you got for us, Ray?
So I actually have two particular groups that like were impactful for me. And so I'm going to speak from that perspective. And one of them is Boogie Down Productions and KRS-One. Mm-hmm. And so I thought a lot about this, because I know when we spoke, I was like, you know, it's all PE all day, every day. And I'm going to get to them in a second. But I think that there's some synchronicity between these two groups and kind of what they were about. And I think, you know, one did influence the other. To me, the risk that was taken with a group like Boogie Down Productions and then with Public Enemy was that, like, you had to hope, you know, that the music, you know.
We lost sound, Ray.
Let me get it up here. Hold on.
Yeah, picking up the mic, man, you got no one to say. Yeah, seeing hip hop started out in Queensbridge. Saying lots like that, man, you know them can't live. So tell them again, me come to tell them again. One, tell them again. Again, me come to tell them again. Tell them again, me come to tell them again. One. Tell them again, me come to tell them. Manhattan keeps on making it. Brooklyn keeps on taking it. Bronx keeps creating it, and Queens keeps on faking it. Yeah.
So why Boogie Down Productions? So this is one of my favorite songs, and I remember being in the projects and like it's the summer, going to play basketball and friends, and just everybody was into Boogie Down Productions. All their music was impactful because the music was like music that gets you moving, but it was also, they were talking about current things that was happening in the communities that you lived in. You didn't have to live in New York to understand or experience people like biting something that you wear or hating on you because of some a girl or a certain pair of shoes. And, you know, all of that was happening in real time. So you could, you know, you could appreciate that. And, you know, you can kind of vibe with it. And I think that was part of the difference. And I mean, we talked a lot about how music was telling a story, Marjorie. And I think that that's, they took pride in storytelling about our neighborhoods, about who we were during that time, for good or bad or indifferent, but it was really storytelling. And I think as a listener, I knew that without them saying, hey, this is storytelling. Like, you understood that. Like, you didn't think, listen to this music, run out in the streets and do what you're hearing people talk about. You just really understood it because it was happening around you. It was like, yeah, like you could appreciate that. And then like for me, like, I think the other piece is the social consciousness piece. And, you know, KRS-One is a historian, you know, and he talked a lot about the socioeconomics in our neighborhoods and some of the inequities in our neighborhoods. And I think to me, that was the education that I got that was different than being at school. Because, you know, today, what are we talking about? Today, we're talking about how a lot of times in school, you're in history, they're missing part of the story, you know, and, or the story's being told differently than it was intended to be told. And I think we're missing that today, as Kevin spoke to. I think we're missing that today in today's music as well. I think we are caught up, and I've said this, you know, on other podcasts that we've had, we are caught up in the capitalism. And if you think about, you know, hip hop music specifically, it's not the same, you know. Hip hop music and rap music was really about, you know, back in the day, it was about, you know, talking about what's going on and, you know, living it and talking about it. You know, it was for us, you know what I mean? And now it's more of a product that is sold to many more people, but it's telling the single story. I don't know if I shared that video with you all. Did I send you all the single story?
No. Yeah, I saw.
All right. So it's more about that. And I think we'll share that with our audience at some point, the single story.
We should do that.
But the PE, the Public Enemy group, I think really took what Boogie Down Productions was doing to a different level. Because it was all about social conscious and Chuck D, you know, really in Flavor Flav. I mean, these guys was living in New York and going and living and seeing like the crack era and all of that start to unfold and how it was adversely affecting our community. And so, you know, we're talking about this 1989. Sound of the fucking drummer. Music hit your heart, cause I know you got a soul. Listen if you're missing, y'all. Swing it while I'm singing. Give it what you're getting. Know what I'm knowing. While the black man sweating. In the rhythm I'm rolling. Gotta give him what you want. Gotta give him what you need. Our freedom of speech is freedom of death. We got to fight the power of that bleed. So
that's another timeless one. Oh my gosh.
We start talking about like how our music has historical context. So you were speaking about Bob Marley, right? And so the other piece about Bob Marley is he reached everybody, but his initial impact was a specific demographic of people in a specific age group, right? And then his influence spread from there. You talk about Public Enemy, you know, what I think about is being a young person and listening to these brothers talking about like, we gotta just be better because this is the game, it's rigged. And as a young person coming up, I was at risk. You know, I grew up in the projects, you know, the crack age was on top of us. They had demonized, you know, what it was to be a crack user. Crack users was black. You know what I mean? It was black people. And not only were we, you know, junkies and crack users, we were breaking the law using the crack. And today, if you think about today, now you got, you know, it's considered a disease, you know, and even then you had as many white people using crack as you did black. But the single story was, it was us. We were selling it. We were shooting and killing. We were selling it only in our neighborhoods. But the backstory, the antecedent was that the drugs coming into America was facilitated by American government. But you didn't hear that story. And these guys talked about the game within the game. You know, Fight the Power was one of those songs that really upset the mainstream America. And it wasn't because of just the lyrics. It was because they were talking about what was true, and they were informing our community of the hurt and harm of the social constructs. And so they took a lot of heat. They weren't chasing the bag. You know what I mean? It wasn't about the bag for them. It was about making an impact in our community. They did videos and all their stuff was homegrown, you know. They talked about incarceration, you know, and how we, you know, return to the terror dome, you know. These are things that, like I said, when I was coming up, that music helped grow me up and help inform me. You know, Tupac helped inform me. You know, Biggie Smalls helped inform me. And you know, Tupac talked about social justice issues as well as, you know, the inequities in our community. And he talked about our community, like what we got to do different.
Mm-hmm. As right. Biggie Smalls.
And so, you know, we really have, if you talk to anybody like my generation younger, like anybody who grew up in the neighborhoods, they'll tell you, like, these are artists that was that easy to highlight. You know, you start talking about the best hip hop artists or rap artists of all time, you're going to have to bring Biggie Smalls up. You're going to have to talk about Public Enemy. You're going to have to talk about, you know, Tupac. You know, there's a whole bunch of, you know, a whole bunch of those artists and groups who are about it. And today's music, I say it to my daughter all the time, it's lacking a message.
No identity.
Yeah, no identity. Let me say this. I think there's an identity, but I think, you know, Tip talks about this all the time. He says that, you know, we are morally, we're without morals in the music now. And so right. Music doesn't have more morality, nor does it have purpose. Our young people will argue that and say it does. It's talking about today's times, and it is. But what's not clear is what's the message, right? Yeah. You could talk about today's times and have a message, right? And today's times for our young people, the artists aren't giving them a message. You know, you go back to Curtis Blow. You know, these are the breaks. You know, Curtis Blow had a message.
Yeah.
You know, music. And not to mention, technically, cats had to really be lyricists. You know, that, you know, they had to get up and like spit lyrics. Now you got what they call mumble rap.
Yeah. And,
you know, you got all these gimmicks and tricks to get the bag. It's not really about the message anymore. It's about capturing.
Yeah, I was gonna say that it's a difference between them, because when you look at KRS, when you look at Public Enemy and the guys from that era, they were teachers and philosophers, right? So they were coming to teach you something, right? Now they're entertainers. That's all they are today. They're entertainers.
Yeah.
So, you know,
true.
Yeah, it's so true. That's the gap right there. They don't have a purpose about you know, filling the minds to uplift people. You know, the whole objective is, let me make this beat, let me make this money so I could go live that lifestyle.
And get that honey.
Yeah.
Hey, Ray, one thing that people did not see coming during your era of music, your era of music was the key that unlocked that door to social alliances. The narrative of the messages that were going on in our neighborhoods and in our home started to cross over. And people started to pay attention that normally they had been banned, that the music was, you know, not encouraged. And people found us. They started to listen to our story. I mean, it's just like our present day politics right now. They're trying to rewrite history. The history was in the music, and people outside of that circle all of a sudden got the message.
It's true. It's true. And I I always think about an interview I saw, and I think I told you guys this story before, but it was Tupac. Tupac was on with Barbara Walters. we could probably pull a video up. And she was asking him about the history of music as well. And he and she, her question was specific to like, so what changed, right? How did the music change over time from, you know, just kind of rapping about what's going on and not it not being threatening, right? So what she was alluding to was the strong messaging that had to do with social justice, that had to do with the government, that had to do with policing. She was asking, well, what caused that to for it to change to gangster rap, right? And what he said was, in short, if you are outside of a hotel room and they got food inside and you're hungry and you're like knocking on the door, you're trying to get food, and somebody opens the door and a piece of salami comes flying out. This was the story. And then the person at the door don't let you in. They say, oh, we ain't got no food in here, but you just got a piece of salami fly out the door. And then they close the door on your face. And so you knock a little harder the next time. Like, you know, you're like, I'm hungry. You know, I want to eat something. That's the lyric. That was the lyrics at the time, right? And they open the door and they're like, yo, there's no food here. Close the door on your face again. Then it turns into kicking the door, bringing the 4-4, right? So what he was trying to explain to her was that conditions changed the music. The music didn't change on its own. And what she was missing is the value in the music for population and demographic of people. So for us, and Marjorie talked about it, you talked about it too, knowing, you know, that the artists and kind of how they lived life during that time in our community, if you go back to Africana, right, where the symbolic ways in which we moved in community were with music and drums and communal and together and dance and celebration for everything, birthrights, celebrating transition from womanhood to manhood, like all those womanhood to woman, from woman, young woman to womanhood, man, young man to manhood, all those traditions were around food, around music and communal. So yeah. Our communities were very much that way as well, right? And here's what's crazy. Some of the attributes came from, you know, us being brought to this land against our will. We didn't lose that. Right, somehow, some way, think about it, historical timeline, Underground Railroad, right? We shall overcome. There's a baseline for us using music to not just survive, but to heal and to educate and inform. That's what our music has always been about. That's been the purpose of our music, right? And so when you were in school, did you learn that, Marjorie, that our music was about, you know, about healing, informing and educating in our community? What about you, Kevin? Did you learn that in school? Did they tell you that was the power?
I had to find that myself through my own research and, you know, my own work and effort. No one taught me that. Yeah.
Well, so ask yourself, how did that thread sustain itself? Us being historically taken from our lands, our origins, brought to this soil, what does that tell you about the power in the music, you know, for us, right? Now, fast forward 2021, 22, the 2000s, right? And how so many of our young people are disconnected from the value in that. You got J. Cole, yeah, J. Cole's doing the thing, no doubt. But, and you know, you got a few cats here and there, but at the end of the day, they've now succumbed to this capitalism. And so, what capitalism does is they trade you the bag for your morals and your ability. When I say your ability to reach your own and teach your own, right? And we get lost, and I said this to you guys before, distracted by democracy and capitalism. This is the only country that puts the flag before the cross.
Yeah. You know?
The music is indicative of that. And I'm speaking specifically to our community.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, you know, BDP and Public Enemy and even Run DMC.
I went to school with two of them.
Yeah, there's a list of these guys, you know, yeah. Tupac. I talk about Tupac, Biggie Small, Jay-Z. You know, these guys understood, you know, they understood what was happening around them. You know, when drug dealing was going on in our communities, this music was popular. Popular.
Yeah.
Right? And so you make the correlation between the two, right? Right. And you call it, you know, gangster rap, right? Yeah. And so the story that gets told about our music, if we don't own the narrative to the story, then it dissipates and goes away, or it becomes a different story. But anyway, that 80s, 90s was all about learning for me. I learned a lot. All the best music. I still listen to this music in my car now because it brings me back. It helps me remember, you know, why when I go into spaces as an educator, I can see things that other people can't. It helps me to understand the language under the language, right? Because I can put my lived experience into context in a structure, you know, when I talk to people, I can speak to them in their language and deconstruct their language, you know, because of my education outside of schoolhouse with the music and the projects. I wouldn't change that experience. At this stage, I understand it's invaluable. You can't go buy that. You can't go back and buy what I lived.
Right.
I tell my daughter this, I tell anybody who listens this. I have a PhD on other levels that no matter how much money you got, you can't buy that.
Right.
And the difference is I understand it and I appreciate it now.
And that's the difference between education and being educated. When you're educated in the school of life and your position in history and being present, that's the education. Now, you brought me back and I don't know if any of you guys saw One Night in Miami when Muhammad Ali was telling Sam Cooke with his music, and Sam Cooke was telling all that he had and what he was getting and whatever, and Muhammad Ali tried to tell him what his music had to mean something to him. And then Sam Cooke got a chance to perform at the Apollo. And for any of those people that have not known what the Apollo is, it is by far the toughest audience.
Yes.
you either are, or they confirm who you're not.
Yes. Yes.
When he had a group that basically unplugged the sound system of his music, you know, he went back to what Muhammad Ali had told him about the music, and he started clapping his hands, got everyone to beat when they were about to boo him, whatever. Okay. And then all of a sudden he came out with that smooth, sexy voice. Oh my gosh, I wish I can do what Sam Cooke did. All day long, I work so hard till the sun is going down. Working on the highways and byways, and sometimes wearing a little frown. You hear the moan the lives away, then you hear somebody say, hey, that's the son of a man working on the game. Son of a man working on the chain gang.
Yes.
Yeah, buddy.
Yeah. Listen, we always had a message in the music, you know, historically. One of my groups I forgot to mention is that clan, Wu-Tang Clan.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. There was about it too.
Yeah.
You know, and to your point, Kevin, earlier about the entrepreneurship of the music, and this is something that our young people miss as well. Wu-Tang produced all of its own music. Created music, you know, we got all the technology that they use today. Wu-Tang was one of the originators of using that technology, you know, from the backdrops of Shaolin martial arts movies playing in the background of the music. Talk about not just producing their own stuff, but the creativity was unlike we'd ever seen before. They've got more music. They've got libraries of music. Right. And it's the same thing. It's all about like our community and what was happening during those times. And I mean, like I can think about songs and you know, you got Nas was talked about affirmative action. You know what I mean? Biggie talked about the 10 crack commandments. You know, y'all remember that one?
Yep.
Yeah, that was that serious, right? That wasn't about that wasn't about outside of our community. What? This was happening, right? And you know what's crazy is like if you listen to this song, he talks about the rules, right? There's rules to this. I wrote you a manual, step by step, a booklet. So you don't get yourself hurt out here in these streets. There was rules then. And I'm not affirming selling dope or being in gangs, but what I am saying is this brother was educating, right? And so if you want to be out here in these streets, understand how it works. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's hard for people to understand who are not amongst or who don't understand what that life was like. I lived that. Like, I know what that was about, what he was talking about, you know? That learning, and then you're making a choice. What do we say all the time? When we make decisions and we have all the information, then we're choosing. Otherwise, we're reacting to conditions, right? When you get to choose, I always tell young people this, leadership is about choosing, right? You choose because you're informed and you understand what's happening, you're making a choice. But when you're reacting to conditions, it's likely that you don't have all the information, then that's about survival. Yeah. Living is choosing. Living is also survival. It's both and. We got in our community, we have a big population of people that are living through survival, and we have yet to learn how to choose to live, whether it's social economics, whether it's health, right? And not taking good care of ourselves, you know, eating poorly, living a lifestyle that's not productive. You know, we have to understand. And you know, when I think about Biggie was teaching. You know what I'm saying? He was like, listen, there's rules to this game. So if you're going to be out here playing in the streets, you got to understand what the rules are. Right. You know, and today's young people, like I play this music for my daughter. And she was like, wow, daddy, he was on some next level. Yeah, he was on some next level with it. You know,
that's the message in the music.
Yes.
You know, that's what it's all about. The message in the music. I think we reduce music down to a good beat. And some of the music today, like really, I'll listen to it because the beat is hitting, but the lyrics, oh my gosh, I could do without it. You know what I mean? So it's because it's not feeding my mind. It's not, you know? And the images and the pictures and the story that it's telling is not something for me personally. Like that's not my thing. Yeah. But I think this conversation is important, right? We had some fun going through the decades. And looking at music all the time. But I think that we want to continue this conversation because you have a point to make, Evan?
Yeah.
I was getting ready to close up. Go ahead.
Ruben. Yeah, because of the two things that you guys said about music and our choices, strolling through Instagram the other day, I ran upon a video of a song that's been released. And I was watching the video. There was one white lady and a black and a young sister, both butt naked. The rappers were standing on a very expensive car, throwing dollar bills out. And as they panned through the audience, as they panned through the audience, there were women sitting on their boyfriend's lap, watching the video being made, but there were also small children. And so I know we've had conversations about image. We've had conversations about our position with the N-word. It's not a term of an endearment and so forth. But when you look at the music and look at the responsibility of the actions of your music, you have to think about your daughter, your son, what they see and what they're interpreting of what they see and your responsibility to the music out there. So, you know, those two young ladies that were nude in that video for cash was someone's daughter. Could be one day someone's mother, could be one day someone's aunt, and that video is out there for life. So, you know, Just remember that for those people that are creating this music, change the narrative and play your music and create content that moves people, inspires people.
And, you know, I'm all for For those of you that know me, I'm all for voice, right? Your voice, using your voice. Your voice is your voice. Your story is your story, right? You get to tell it the way you want to. And it's not my place to rewrite it or whatever. But I do think that there's a responsibility when we use our voice. There's a responsibility in artistic expression, right? We talk about artistic freedoms and expressions, and I'm all for that too. But again, what's the purpose behind it? What's the intent behind it? What are you meant to move with it? And that's the question that I think is going to be self-reflective for all artists. Some artists create, listen, I've got art in here that I've painted and done. It's not for nobody's eyes to see. That's just for me, my self-expression at that moment. And then there are some pieces that I know it's ready because this is going to inspire or move or impact someone, right? Or I just want to share it. So I think we all have a responsibility in that. And I think as we continue this conversation and we talk more about music itself as an art form, as another way to tell stories and use your voice, we're going to be talking more about the responsibility we all have, the responsibility the artist has to the listener and to their community at large with what they are sharing. We're looking to get some new upcoming artists on. They're close friends of Ray. We want to bring them on because their music, it reminds me so much of exactly what you were talking about, the Tribe Called Quest and that group back in that era, you know, where the music was just, it just blew your mind, but at the same time, you're ready to dance. And so we're going to bring them on, have a conversation with them. Kevin's going to reach out to some people. If you know, you know, you guys listening, if you know of any artist that falls into this category of, you know, Black consciousness and protest music, we'd like to bring them on as part of this series. Maybe even have a roundtable discussion with all of them. Some of them that do use the N-word in their music. Some of them that, you know, they talk about things that really that's their life, that's their story, and this is how they're going to tell it. And for others who just have a different type of story they want to tell, give everybody a chance to share it. So with that, we're going to end today's episode, and we want to thank you again for joining us on One Queen, Two Queens. Driving so slow, but BK is from Texas. Me, I'm out that bad stop, home of that boy Biggie. Now I live on Billboard, and I'm from my boy Biggie. Came up the tie-top, still sipping my top, sitting courtside, Nixon, that's giving me...